All right, welcome to part one of our new series we're calling Fantasy Island. Now, some of you guys remember a guy named Ricardo Montalban, right? He was also a Chrysler pitchman. Remember the Chrysler Cordoba with the Corinthian leather, which meant it was pleather, not leather. But Ricardo Montalban was a famous actor, and there's this show, and it was called Fantasy Island. And it was for people who wanted to mess with their reality. It was for people who wanted to create some unreality that they thought was better than their reality. And he had the little guy, I forget, Tattoo, the little guy, Tattoo, and he would always welcome the people, and he'd say, "Yes, boss," you know, and he'd welcome the people, and the people would get off this plane, and they would land at Fantasy Island, they would get off the plane, and Ricardo Montalban would come out, and he'd go, "Welcome. Welcome to Fantasy Island," you know, and so there was Ricardo and his little small man assistant, Tattoo, and then the stories of the different people would be, you know, how they would want to create some fantasy, and over time, their fantasy would get played out, but their fantasy didn't always work out the way they wanted. In fact, a lot of times in the story, a person's fantasy actually brought them back to reality, and it made them want their reality more than the fantasy. Well, I'm taking on this topic of fantasy because it is epidemic. I mean, on the continuum of fantasy, there's innocent fantasy, right? Childhood dreams, right? Like the Disneyland kind, right? Isn't there a section of Disneyland called Fantasyland? And it has princes and knights, and you know, that's the innocent side of fantasy. But here's what happens, okay? As we age and reality starts to bite. In other words, as the realities of Earth and as we age and our emotional maturity grows, we all of a sudden come face to face with reality and loss and brokenness. And all of a sudden, our ideal dreams and fantasies of who we're going to become or what we're going to do kind of gets tempered a little bit. And then we have to grow up. And we have to grow into the tension, right? This is maturity. The tension of managing hard realities. Okay? And some people grow up and into adulthood, which is synonymous with the ability to manage hard realities, or people grow into adulthood that is complete with hard realities and they don't want to manage the tension of hard realities. So, what do? They develop alternative realities to their hard realities, and they end up living a fantasy life in the middle of reality. Nowhere is this more evident right now than the New York Times best-selling trilogy called 50 Shades of Grey. You may have heard about it. It's actually a book for women, and it's about a woman who falls in love with a man who's into some very sadistic sexual stuff. And it's this phenomenon where you have millions and millions of women who are chasing this fantasy, and they're buying up the book, and there's book clubs, and there's all this stuff. Well, I was on a radio show just the other day here in LA, and I wanted to take it on because what it suggests is this, especially on the female side. We know the male side. When men chase power and possession and pleasure and they chase all of these things, and it comes with all the responsibilities of being a man, men have created this subculture of fantasy to deal with the pressures of their reality. Guess what, guys? Women in about less than 40 or 50 years have now, because of their chase, achieved a lot of the things that men have, and now we have not just broken male culture of fantasy, we have broken female culture of fantasy. Women have more independence, more economic independence, more intellectual independence, more power, more responsibility, and isn't it true, when you have more responsibility and more power, you sign up for more pressure. Amen? So we chase, we get, we bear the burden, and then all of a sudden the burden pressures us, and then it tests our character. whether or not we can handle the burden of the power that we have, the burden of the responsibilities we have, the burden of our choices that we have, the burden of responsibility, the burden of our commitments, the burden of our sacrifices, that pressure tests character. And then here's what happens. Listen to me. We get to see if our character has the ability to meet the demands of our reality. And here's the dividing point. And this is where we're going to launch into our discussion of fantasy. So you have pressure, life, okay, comes upon a man and a woman. That tests their character. And then we get to see how we deal with the pressure, how we deal with the conflict, how we deal with the chaos. And then it goes one of two ways. We go toward maturity, and we face reality, and we embrace reality, and we grow up in reality, and we learn as adults to manage the tension of reality. Okay, that's our hope for our kids. Or we go and start trying to escape that pressure of commitment and that pressure of responsibility and that pressure of sacrifice that goes with reality. And now we have this whole movement of fantasy. And that's what's happening. That's what's happening with women, interestingly enough, right now. Okay? So that's why we're going into this discussion called Fantasy Island, because here's the deal. When you escape into fantasy, does it eliminate or vaporize your responsibility to the realities of your life? Absolutely not. And then that's the double dog frustration. It's either we grow up and into our responsibilities and maturity as adult men, or we develop a double life and we create diversions and escapes and fantasies. And to the tune of, at least in the sexual side of fantasy, I'm not talking about fantasy football or gaming or any side of that. I'm just talking about porn. 57 billion? I mean, any one of us could become a millionaire today. I'm not advocating that. It's like I was reading Fast Company. And there was a picture of this lady with a low-cut blouse. It's actually a cartoon. It wasn't even a real person. And she had a little negligee on, and she had a pitchfork and horns, and all it said was curious on the box, and it gave a URL. Millionaires. Why? See, that's the question. Why? Because guys are laboring under realities that pressure them, that tests their character and their ability to meet the demands of their realities as men. And then we have this bifurcation of their energy and their expression. Instead of facing their realities or getting help or turning to spiritual help or turning to friends or working it out with their wife or whatever, instead, that's too hard. It's emotionally too heavy. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to find relief in a relationship with a pixelized woman or woman who doesn't ask any questions, who lets me do what I want. And in that sense, I make up for this lost sense of power and control in my life. You see, the source of fantasy, okay, is a discontentment. Listen, a discontentment, a dissatisfaction, or a desire to replace your reality. That is the bottom line. So in this series, what I want to do really well up front is to define, you know, why fantasy, define it at its roots, okay? Fantasy as a desire for an unreality, and then talk about the source, which is truly a discontentment, a dissatisfaction, and a desire to replace your reality. Now, God is big on truth and reality. When you have all this stuff going on in your life, when you have negative emotions and pressures and situations, we have to remember that a good dad exposes his kids to increasing amounts of responsibility and commitment and pressure. A good dad does. A bad dad bubble wraps his kids, insulates them, and then when he releases them to the world, they're not ready for reality. And in a masculine sense, Okay? We have a lot of boys versus men. We have millions, 57 billion worth, at least pointing and clicking through, that have no ability to meet the demands of their reality. And that's not God's plan. So if you're affected by fantasy in any way, or if you're raising a son, or if you are influencing other men in any way, you have to know how to talk about this. Why? Because it's the wallpaper of our masculine lives. It's everywhere. It's a temptation. And let me tell you who has a big stake in the game of fantasy. Satan himself. Why? Because while it's God's will that we grow up and into our realities and we become mature and we become adults and we know how to negotiate the tensions of life, which Jesus said there would be, Satan's plan is the exact opposite. He wants us, when the pressure comes, okay, and the tension comes and the realities come, he wants us to medicate our reality. He wants us to go into this realm of escapism. He wants us to move and convince ourselves and rationalize not embracing reality, but escaping reality. So this is true spiritual warfare. And here's how we're going to address the issue of fantasy. Not from the surface level. Okay, we're not going to look at it and go, that's bad and that's good. We're not going to take the religious approach, okay? We're going to take the spiritual approach, because the spiritual approach knows that problems seldom exist at the level at which you see them. So if I see a guy, or if I see a boy, or if I see even women moving into fantasy and unreality that's harmful for them, okay, or a son even, the problem doesn't exist at the level at which I see it. It exists at a deeper level. It exists at a root level. It exists at a spiritual level. It exists at an emotional level. It exists at a relational level. So as I say that, I'm not going to chastise you for your behavior or anyone's behavior for engaging in fantasy. I realize that there's reality, I realize there's pressure, I realize people deal with that pressure in different ways, and there's healthy and unhealthy ways of dealing with it. But I'm not looking at the symptom, I'm looking at the root. And so I want to examine the issue of fantasy from the level of what it reveals about our reality. Because usually, the escape into fantasy has to do with a spiritual reality below the surface, a relational reality below the surface, an emotional reality underneath the surface, or a mental reality that's there underneath the surface. Okay, that's our tee up, all right? Fantasy, a desire or need for an unreality. What is it rooted in? It's rooted in a discontentment, dissatisfaction, or desire to escape what's real in your life. So let's begin with a discussion of reality. And the first thing that we want to talk about, if you have a Bible, I want you to open it to John chapter 9. And the first thing we want to talk about is reality. If you're going to talk about fantasy, you got to talk about reality, because fantasy is a desire to escape reality. Okay? And the first thing that we need to know about our reality, look up here, is that our reality, our right now life, is God's glory. So say this with me. My reality is God's glory. Okay. What does that mean? It means that everything happening in your life right now, good and bad, is where God's glory is. Everything you don't like in your life right now, that reality is God's glory. Everything you want to keep a secret, every temptation, that reality can be redeemed and become God's glory. Everything in your life right now that feels uncomfortable, especially the uncomfortable things of your life, okay? That reality is the incubator of God's glory. Things that seem negative to you, okay? is the incubator of God's glory. And it's that life and that reality that God wants to use. Versus what? My cleaned up life, my materially rich life, my sexy life, my well-appointed life, my everything's in order life. Okay, now why does God want to use my unsanitized reality versus my cleaned up image and fantasy life? It's because in one life, God gets the glory, and in the other life, you get the glory. Okay, He prefers your struggles over your strengths. And He jumps into our lives, I know I can get a testimony on this one, into the less than ideal chapters and moments versus the ideal chapters and moments of our lives. And in John 9, what we see is we see one of those pictures of how a very harsh reality God wants to use for His glory, okay? And in John 9, we read about the blind man. And just to tee it up for you, the story goes that there's a blind boy, there's a healing by Jesus of the blind boy, and then there's an investigation of the blind boy's event by religious guys, okay? And the disciples are questioning what's responsible for this? Why is this reality a part of this boy's life? And in the first three verses, we see Jesus say this. As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. Okay, that's the harsh reality. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Listen to Jesus' response in verse 3. Neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus. Let's finish verse 3 together. But this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. Isn't this interesting? Okay? You have a harsh reality. Your child's blind. Okay? It's a tension. There's actually a social stigma attached to being blind. There is this mistaken assumption in that culture in that time that someone blew it somewhere along the line. Someone made a mistake. Okay, either he sinned or his parents sinned. And there's a lot of negative feelings associated with that. When you get separated and highlighted because of some handicap, that creates all sorts of negative feelings. And so the disciples, thinking like cultural men, said, so who blew it? That this guy is the consequence of somebody making a bad choice and God's punishing them. You notice Jesus' response. Neither this man nor his parents sinned. So, let's just put that aside. But this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. So, what's the point? Is that that reality, that harsh reality, was the incubator for God's glory. Now, as the story moves along, you keep reading John chapter 9, you see that come to pass. You see Jesus heal the blind man so that harsh reality is redeemed by Jesus, okay? The negative situation redeemed by Jesus. And then God gets the glory, and the blind man actually becomes a believer later in the story. All right? Now, what's the point? You have to begin, like the disciples had to learn, to open yourself up to the possibility, all right, that God is using the hard realities in your life for his glory and for his purposes. You see, we're sold one of two messages in culture, and that is that you deserve the yellow brick road. And there's this expectation that's built on it. You know what? I'm supposed to grow up in a great family and be raised by great people and have this great life, and I'm going to be provided and protected for, and then I'm going to go, you know, to get educated, then I'm going to get a job, and then I'm going to make money, and then I'm going to meet the girl of my dreams, and then we're going to have kids, and we're going to reproduce exactly this great life that I grew up with, and it's just going to sail like this, right like that. Now, reality is more like this. Whoop, whoop, whoop. You know, and those down slopes on the road to maturity and the road to, you know, an authentic life always involves these little hiccups or big hiccups, amen? The big hiccups of life. And at those points right there where you're kind of dealing with, you know, okay, yeah, maybe I had two parents, but maybe my dad was an alcoholic. Or maybe I had two parents, but they didn't protect me against this person, you know? And these things happen. These harsh realities happen. Those little downturns, those hard things, those hard issues. You know, I was going along in my marriage, and then all of a sudden, woo, you know? Then all of a sudden, we stopped getting along, and we didn't know each other anymore, and I started working more, and we got distant, and it's really hard. Those downturns, those are the places that God can redeem the best and show his glory, okay? But the other voice, Satan, in those spots with those issues, he does not want you to recognize that God can redeem and restore and renew and resuscitate those situations to bring glory to himself. He just says, bail, bro. Get out of there. You know what one of his big lines is? You didn't sign up for this. He'll get you down a slippery slope of rationalization, justification, and accusation to get you wanting an alternative reality, okay? Which then now excludes God from redeeming and getting glory. Are you tracking with me? That's how it works. And so we're sold this bill of goods, like life's supposed to be like this. And then the mistake is that adversity means the lack of God's presence and the lack of God's will and the lack of God's glory. And prosperity means the presence of God's will and the presence of God's glory. Well, you know what? The cross settles all issues on that whole discussion, doesn't it? The cross of Jesus Christ. Now, you look at that and you go, if adversity means the lack of God's presence and the lack of prosperity, then what's up with that? Because that is my presence and that is my prosperity. That is my whole spiritual life. Okay? So, your reality is God's glory. And just remember that Satan has a big stake in you escaping your hard realities versus embracing and facing and trusting yourself to God and his promises. Now, here's a question, and it's individual, whether you're in a men's small group watching this or you're here in the worship center. What issue in your life is a hard reality? Many of you are sitting here listening this morning or listening by video. And you're totally disconnected from your spouse emotionally. Careful. Because if you don't win intimacy with your spouse, if that's too uncomfortable for you, if the issues are too hard for you to discuss, if the truth about yourself and your contribution to the disconnection is too difficult for you to work on, guess what? You're already in the realm of fantasy. Whether it's thinking about being with another woman or just wishing she was gone from your life or just wishing that she would turn into someone else. You see, it starts with this innocent stuff, but then it graduates. And typically, most affairs and most fantasy start with an unwillingness to deal with reality in the relationship. Maybe you're single, okay? Maybe you're a single dude. Okay? And you want to be married. And let's just put the squirmy worm on the table. The main reason men want to be married is so that they can get to know a woman. Okay? I mean, my son is like, Dad, is the rapture going to happen anytime soon? Because, you know, I mean, like, where are we in the biblical eschatological spectrum? Because I'm just, Ryan, relax, bro, because whatever you would miss sexually is going to be made up. If Jesus comes now, you're not going to be worrying about not sleeping with a woman, okay? Relax, all right? Now I'm totally far afield. But when it comes to, you know, the tension right? We go into that, and if you're a single dude, you're just like, okay, so I want to be here. I want to be here, but my reality is that I'm here. So why do you think that high school boys and single guys are just absolutely guzzling porn? Because they have a need for intimacy, but they don't like their reality. They don't want to let God work with that. Hey, I'm single. I'm growing up. I got to learn discipline. I got to learn responsibility. I have to learn commitment. Okay? And given, you know, that they have high levels of testosterone, I get that, but they want to be here. They don't want their reality. So what they do is they create relationships with women, and then guess what happens? Satan wins. Here's how he wins. I mean, I just read all these articles on this. So they go and they engage in fantasy online, and they create all these relationships with women before they actually have a real relationship with a woman. And then they habituate fantasy and masturbation and all these deviant sexual things. And they one, start practicing sex in a way that they're not intended. And then two, create imaginary expectations of what a woman is and what a woman should do. So they've already laid the quicksand for their destruction in marriage. And so now I get emails from young men who are diving into fantasy because they don't like the reality of their singleness. And they're saying, you know what, disaster on the wedding night. Why? Because they habituated a way of thinking and acting out sexually that was inconsistent with a 98.6 degree woman who needs conversation and dinner and engagement, not just self-gratification. You follow me? She's real. And guess what happens? And I kid you not. Why? Because they habituated a way of approaching their lives that wasn't comfortable with reality. They wanted the fantasy. They wanted to grow up too quick. Instead of letting God mature them and use their circumstances to grow them up and teach them discipline and teach them patience and teach them how to engage women in the right way versus just physically, which is the easiest one. And then they jumped ahead and they jumped into fantasy, and then they started living and thinking about women and sex and life and relationships in a deceitful, evil way, and then they meet the girl of their dreams. She comes into their life, and oh, she's awesome. And then they go to the wedding night and the wedding bed, but they have habituated a way of being and thinking that does not jive with reality. Disaster. These kids, these boys that are diving into porn and creating that life, they are devastated, they are depressed, their wives are devastated, their wives are depressed. All because they didn't want to have a good relationship with their reality. Let's just say something together. Say, it is never God's will for God's man to run or escape from his reality. Your reality is God's glory. And he wants to work in your reality. And he wants to glorify himself in your realities, especially the unsanitized ones, especially the ones where you have to struggle, especially the ones where there's tension. So my question to you is, where is your hard reality? And some of you have been in that hard reality for a long time. But God wants to glorify himself, even if it means that a man stood with integrity in a hard reality over a long period of time and did the right thing and was the right man, so that God gets the glory when he gets to see you, even if it's that. And this will be worth this, the discipline of this. The second thing we need to learn about reality and its relationship to fantasy is, my reality is the way to my maturity. I want you to turn in the Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And this is the love chapter, okay? We've been talking about love, but this is the love chapter, and you see this read at a lot of weddings. What a lot of people don't realize, it's like they embrace 1 Corinthians chapter 13, especially verses that we're gonna look at, 4 through 11, in a kind of an idealistic way versus a realistic way. Okay, I'm going to read it, and then we'll engage the passage in a realistic way. Okay, verse 4. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It's not proud. It's not rude. It's not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth.
It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stifled and stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. Key verse 11. Let's read it together. When I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. You see, this passage is about maturity. Okay, and you can't develop maturity unless you're in hard realities. You can't develop patience. Love is patient. You can't develop patience unless you're in a situation that creates the tension that demands that you not be impulsive and impatient, okay? You can't develop kindness unless there's the possibility in your circumstances to be harsh with somebody. You can't become content unless you're in a situation where the possibility is there for you to be envious. And it goes on and on. It talks about pride. It talks about rudeness. It talks about selfishness. It talks about being easily angered. It talks about you being bitter. It talks about delighting in evil. It talks about the ability to protect others and to trust others and to have hope and to persevere. And all of those qualities are maturity qualities. But maturity never develops in a vacuum. You see, when your kids are little, you do bubble wrap them, especially in the early years, okay? You bubble wrap them and you wrap them in lots of Pampers, okay? But then as they age, you are recommended to not protect them as much because as an adult, they're going to get exposed to pressure-filled situations, okay? And in this passage, we see this evolution, and at the end, he says, when I was a child, I thought like a child, reasoned like a child, acted like a child, but when I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. How do you do that? Well, you get exposed to reality, and as you're exposed to reality, you make choices, and you become responsible and committed and disciplined, and you grow, okay? You become mature. And when you become mature in the context of tension and hard realities, situations that demand more character from you, then you leave the boy and you become the man. Here's the problem. And this is what women tell me all the time through emails, radio shows. They say, you know what I want? You know what I need? I need a 20-year-old 20-year-old. I need a 30-year-old 30-year-old. I need a 40-year-old 40. I need a 60-year-old 60-year-old, not a 60-year-old 16-year-old, a 50-year-old 15-year-old, and a 40-year-old 14-year-old. Where when it comes to my guy facing realities, he goes back to eighth grade. And the world is desperate for men who act their what? Their age. Wow, it's so easy to stand out these days, fellas. All we gotta do, especially you young dudes, you just gotta act your age, you know? But that's why there's this retreat into fantasy because reality's too hard and in the age bracket of 20 to 34, gaming is just way, way up because it's just too hard to be a responsible, committed, loyal dude. So we're gonna retreat and become great in the realm of Xbox till 3 o'clock in the morning. Can I tell you guys, if you're up till 3 o'clock in the morning watching Xbox, I just have one thing to say to you. Stop it. Grow up. Engage reality. Get a job. Earn a wage. Go to work. Marry that girl. Reality is the way to maturity. And somehow along the line, it got difficult. And then all of a sudden, all the boys started retreating into fantasy instead of engaging reality in what we have. And guess what? The post-feminist, sweet, sensitive guy, they're annoyed and bored by him now. They don't like him. Why? Because he's not a man. Thus, the migration over to fantasy by women, because the men they've created, who's sweet and sensitive and not strong and responsible, now there's this exodus of women over to fantasy, and guess what their fantasy is? Sexual domination. Is that, like, messed up? They want a relationship with a guy, but then they want to be dominated by a guy in fantasy, which means that that hidden desire in them for a strong man and to be led in a healthy way by a strong man gets perverted. And that's what they want deep down, to be led by a healthy, strong, responsible guy. But because they can't find any, now they're going into fantasy and Satan's going like this. Here, 50 Shades of Grey, 50 Shades of Grey, 50 Shades of Grey. Read this. It's a movement. So the second thing is, my reality is the way to maturity. Third thing, and then we'll go to discussion. My reality is the path to spiritual integrity. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, one of my favorite passages of Scripture, what you see is dudes confronting a hard reality that brings integrity. 2 Timothy 2, 1 through 4 says, "You then, my son, be strong." Say, be strong. Be strong, okay? So the exhortation is to be strong. Be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Okay, that's the headline. Be strong in God's acceptance and affirmation of you, okay, as a man. Why? Listen up. "And the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to" what kind of men? Reliable. Strong, reliable, okay? "Who will also be qualified to teach others." Why? Why am I telling you to be strong and to mentor and disciple other men to be strong and reliable? Verse 3, "Endure" what? Endure hardship with us like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs. He wants to please his commanding officer. Similarly, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not receive the victor's crown unless he competes according to the rules. The hardworking farmer should be the first to receive a share of the crops. Verse 7, let's read it together. "Reflect on what I am saying, for the Lord will give you insight into all of this." My reality is the path to spiritual strength and integrity. Now, each of those guys, the soldier, the athlete, and the farmer, all confronted harsh realities. The soldier can't just decide, "I'm not a soldier, I'm gonna go live a civilian life, or else I won't please my commanding officer." The athlete just can't say, "Wow, this race is hard. If I didn't compete according to the rules, then maybe I'd win." He can't do that. That's his reality, so he has to stay in the tension of competing according to the rules. The farmer can't say, "Oh, well, you know, and I'm gonna sleep in this morning, and, you know, maybe just the crops and the soil will till itself." No, he has to get up at O dark 30 and stand behind some big ox that's pooping out the back. The hardworking farmer, okay? All these dudes have a hard reality that they have to face and confront so that they can achieve integrity of identity and responsibility and loyalty. And then Paul says, "Reflect on what I'm saying." Your reality right now, your hard reality, is the path toward your spiritual integrity. When guys come to me and say, "You know what, my marriage is really struggling, I'm thinking about filing for a divorce, or I'm really struggling with porn," or whatever their hard reality is that's wanting them to escape, I'm saying, stay there. Stay. She's not a toaster. If she breaks, you don't throw her away. Stay in the relationship. Stay in the problem. It's never God's will for you to run from a problem. God wants to work his glory in your reality, and your legacy and integrity depend on how you respond in this situation. So, for discussion, here's your question. What reality or pressure in your life has the ability to make you consider an alternative reality or fantasy? Now, why am I having you answer that question? Because I want you to know that your reality is God's glory. Your reality is going to reveal your maturity, and that reality is going to bring you to spiritual integrity. Let's talk about that for 15 minutes. We'll come back and wrap it up. Go for it. Okay, let's wrap up part one of Fantasy Island. The reason we're calling it Fantasy Island is because fantasy is a what? Island. Yeah. It separates you from reality. It separates you from God's glory. It separates you from maturity. It separates you from spiritual integrity. And it connects you directly on the island of fantasy to isolation emotionally, disconnection relationally, depression mentally, and dysfunction physically. Okay? And Satan is not going to tell you the truth. The culture out there is not going to tell you the truth. Your dark side, all right, ruled by the boy, he's not going to tell you the truth because he's into feelings and feeling better, okay? But God's word and God's men will tell you the truth, of which I am just one. And the truth is this. Your reality is God's glory. Your reality right now, especially the difficult, uncomfortable one, is your path to spiritual and personal maturity. Your reality is the way toward integrity, spiritual integrity. Okay? And I know that when it comes to this whole issue of facing life and facing the tensions and facing our realities, you got two choices, or three choices. Okay? One, you can embrace your life as it is, not as you would have it. Okay, and you can partner with God and work with the realities of your station in life and condition in life, and you can be grateful for your life, all right, and fight the good fight of the faith. And that right there is a man who is choosing the pain of discipline versus the pain of regret, right? That's one way to do it, okay? You can embrace difficulties and trials and tribulations and heartache. Or you can compartmentalize it. You can embrace it or you can compartmentalize it. You can say, well, you know what, I'm living this life, but there are tough things over here, so I'm going to compartmentalize this part of my life over here for some diversion, some fantasy, some attitude, some behavior, something that provides and medicates my reality over here. So that's what we call the double life. And we see it in the headlines all the time. Just think Tiger Woods, okay? He's got one life over here. It's a public life. Then he has a private life. But all everybody sees is the public life until, and eventually it will, your compartmentalized private life will take you down. It will come out, okay? It will lead to a death of sorts. Or, number three, after embrace it, you can just escape it. You can just say, heck with this thing. I'm just bailing on my life, and I'm going to start over, okay? Can I just tell you something? That's a fantasy, okay? Just ask the guys who said, I'm just going to leave the life I have now and start a new one. And ask them, so was the grass greener? And they will tell you, I thought it was going to be, but it's not. All of my responsibilities and my character issues followed me right over here. Either mentally or materially or relationally, okay? Now, I believe better things of you, otherwise you wouldn't be here. Say, I want God's glory. I want spiritual maturity. I want spiritual integrity. See, I believe that you want that, but you can't have that unless you have a relationship with the man who brought God glory, who demonstrated spiritual maturity on earth, and who demonstrated spiritual integrity to perfection. And his name is Jesus. And so I'm going to ask you now to put down your pencils wherever you are, wherever, whatever church you're in, put down your pencils and let's bow our heads. And I want to give you an opportunity to connect with the man. Some of you right now listening to my voice don't have a relationship with Jesus. You might be here in the worship center, or you might be at a men's group, or you might be in a fellowship hall somewhere, and you've been listening to this, and God has been speaking directly to your life. You have some hard realities, and you're not dealing with them very well. And privately, if you were to be honest right now in this moment with yourself, many of you would say, I'm failing. And God has allowed you to get to that spot so that you would be open to the possibility that He really wants to help you. And so God's hand is extended into your hard reality, and you can take it right now by faith and just say, Jesus, I accept you, and I accept your desire for a relationship with me. And I give back to you right now in this moment a desire to know you and accept you and your person and your work for me on the cross. Thank you for going to the reality of the cross for me so I could be cleansed and so that there could be a way for me to know you in this moment. With my sins out of the way, I can know God, and I want to know God. And so I want you in my life, and I want your help, and I want your leadership, and I want your forgiveness. I want all of who you are to make me all that I can be, especially right now. And then there are some of you who've just drifted. You've drifted from the country and citizenship and family of God, and you've created a double life, and you have this little fantasy island, and you need to forsake and repent of that, which means you need to change your mind. And this morning, God's changed your mind. You don't want isolation. You don't want disconnection. You don't want devastation and depression. You want God's glory, maturity, and integrity. And you just might want to say, God, I'm done with it. I'm putting a stake in the ground. I want you, and I want you to use this hard situation. So, God, I pray that you would forgive me, and I thank you that you have, because of the blood of Jesus. I'm back, and I'm forsaking fantasy, and I want to embrace my reality, but it's going to be hard, and I need your presence and help and your people. So, Lord, would you help me now? And keep me connected and close to you. And then there's some of you who need to carry this message to sons and carry this message to other men and with conviction and boldness share the gospel of reality of relationship with God versus encourage or by default and agreement let the life of fantasy just go on unaddressed and let men suffer. You need to be sharing your faith and calling people into relationship with their Lord and their Redeemer and reality. So, Lord, that's all of us. I pray that you would bless every man. I pray that you would bless every men's group. I pray that you would bless every church. And bring us away from Fantasy Island and into the reality of the wonderful love and peace and joy and mercy and healing in Jesus Christ. And God's men said, amen. Amen.